So Srimad Bhagavad-gita, chapter 1, text 1. Title of this chapter is Observing the Armies. Dhritarashtra said, O Sanjaya, after my sons and the sons of Pandava, After my sons and the sons of Pandu assembled in the place of pilgrimage at Kurukshetra, desiring to fight, what did they do? Please kindly respond, repeat. Dhritarashtra said,
O Sanjaya,
after my sons and the sons of Pandu assembled. In a place of pilgrimage at Kurukshetra. Desiring to fight. What did they do? Purport. Bhagavad Gita is the widely read theistic sign summarized in the Gita Mahatmya, glorification of the Gita. Who's read the Gita Mahatmya here? Raise up your hand. I've read the Gita Mahatmya, raise up your hand. It's a very interesting theistic attitude or science, because it gives you a basic information and equips you with knowledge culture of each and every chapter, the benefits you derive by reading the Gita. And then it provides a lot of insightful, thought-provoking stories that could send your mind reeling. Referring to the Gita Mahatmya, there it says that one should read Bhagavad Gita very scrutinizingly with the help of a person who is a devotee of Sri Krishna. I'm trying to understand it without personally motivated interpretations. The example of clear understanding is there in the Bhagavad Gita itself. In a way, the teaching is understood by Arjuna, who heard the Gita directly from the Lord. If someone is fortunate enough to understand the Bhagavad Gita in the line of the cyclic succession without motivated interpretations, then he surpasses all studies of Vedic wisdom and all scriptures of the world. One will find in the Bhagavad Gita all that is contained in other scriptures, but the reader will also find things which are not to be found elsewhere. That is a specific standard of the Gita. It is the perfect theistic science because it is directly spoken by the Supreme Personality of God, Lord Sri Krishna. The topics discussed by Dhritarashtra and Sanjaya, as described in the Mahabharata, form the basic principle for this great philosophy. It is understood that this philosophy evolved on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, which is a sacred place of pilgrimage from the immemorial time of the Vedic age. It was spoken by the Lord when he was present personally on the planet for the guidance of mankind. The word Dharma Chetra is the word Dharma Chetra, a place where religious rituals are performed, is significant because on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, the Supreme Personality of Godhead was present on the side of Arjuna. Dhritarashtra, the father of the Kurus, was highly doubtful about the possibility of his son's ultimate victory. In his doubt, he inquired from his secretary Sanjaya, what did they do? He was confident that both his son and the sons of his younger brother Pandu were assembled in that field of Kurukshetra for a determined engagement of the war. Still, his inquiry is significant. He did not want a compromise between the cousins and brothers, and he wanted to be sure of the fate of his sons on the battlefield. Because the battle was arranged to be fought at Kurukshetra, which is mentioned elsewhere in the Vedas as a place of worship, even for the denizens of heaven, Dhritarashtra became very fearful about the influence of the holy place on the outcome of the battle. He knew very well that this would influence Arjuna and the sons of Pandu favorably, because by nature they were all virtuous. Sanjaya was a student of Vyasa. In other words, Vyasa was his spiritual master. And therefore, by the mercy of Vyasa, Sanjaya was able to envision the battlefield of Kurukshetra even while he was in the room of Dhritarashtra. And so Dhritarashtra asked him about the situation on the battlefield. Both the Pandavas and the sons of Dhritarashtra belong to the same family, but Dhritarashtra's mind is disclosed herein. He deliberately claimed only his sons as Kurus, and he separated the sons of Pandu from his family heritage. One can thus understand the specific position of Dhritarashtra in his relationship with his nephews, the sons of Pandu. As in the party field, the unnecessary plans are taken out. So it is expected from the very beginning of these topics that in the religious field of Kurukshetra, where the father of religion, Sri Krishna, was present, the unwanted plans like Dhritarashtra's son, Duryodhana, and others would be wiped out, and the thorough religious persons headed by Yudhishthira will be established by the Lord. This is the significance of the word Dharma Chetri, Kuru Chetri, apart from their historical and Vedic importance. Om Agyana Timirandasya, Agyana Jana Salakaya, Saksurun Militam, Jena Tismai, Sigurave Namaha, Suchetaya Manovistam, Stafetam Jena Bhutale, Swayam Rupam Kadamayam, Dadati Swa Padantikam. Vandise Krishna Chaitanya Nityananda Sahodatu Godutai Puspavantu Chitu Chandu Tamanati. Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Si Advaita Gadara Sivasadi Sigur Bhaktivinoda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pristaya Bhutale Simate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Itinami Namaste Sarasvati Deva Gauravane Pacharane Anirvisesa Sanyavadi Pashatya Disatari Vancha Kalpatari Bhyacha Kripa Sundubhya Ivacha Patitanam Pavanibhya Krishna Vibhya Namahami Dhritarashtra Huacha Dharma Chete Kuru Chete Samaveta yuyutsavaha mamaka pandavas chiva kim akurvata samje. Kim, what? There are two categories of inquiries. One is transcendental inquiry, and the other one is mundane inquiries. Monetary inquiries has to do with facilitation or what provides us with the best to, or to the best of our interest. So here, the trouser, it's been mentioned in the purport, that although he was very far away from the battlefield, by the help of Sanjaya, who is a student, who is a mentee, who is a disciple of Vyasa, he was able to know exactly what was transpiring on the battlefield. So right in the beginning, Dhritarashtra has to make some inquiries because, in a sense, he was in anxiety. He was worried. He knew very well that the sons of his brother, the sons of Pandu, they were very pious. They're religious people. If you are highly religious, you don't give a damn to anything that is going to transpire. If you're very spiritual, you're very devotional, you don't give a damn. You're waiting. What? If the worst happens, it's fine. If the best happens, all glories to Krishna. If even the worst happens, so-called worst, all glories to Krishna. But the non-devotees, they are always in anxiety. They are afraid of what they are going to lose. They're happy when they acquire the facilities, and when they acquire the facility, that fear is a concomitant factor of facility acquisition. And so here, Dhritarashtra, they have acquired the facilities, they have, you know, taken everything, but the fear of losing it becomes a problem. So in that fear, some preparations have to be made. So he's trying to figure out what could be the fate of his sons. Inquiries. It's so important. Each and every firm you go to, each and every organization you go, there is always a provision for receptions, for inquiries. An office for inquiries. A kiosk for inquiries. Even if you have a program outdoors, there is always a kiosk for inquiries. Inquiries is so important. So we may have so many things to deal with, but we need to know the, you know, fundamental things that are associated with that very situation. And so if we don't know, we make humble inquiries. So with the human platform, the inquiries is basically very critical in the sense that it requires a lot of thought provocation. It requires a lot of evaluation, reassessment, reasoning, logic, and a correlation of all of these outcomes to the instructions of the Lord in the form of the Bhagavad Gita or the Srimad Bhagavatam. Because our logic alone is not enough. Our reasoning alone is not enough. And so we always have to make that correlation. And if there is high correlation between our logic, our thought pattern, and what Krishna has spoken or what Krishna has prescribed, then we are on a good path. But otherwise, we need to have a redress. So Sanjaya, basically, this is the problem with usurpation. When you usurp someone's assets or properties, you just be in anxiety. I mean, it's like a robber. If you go to steal and acquire the money, again, you are in anxiety. You have anxiety about the cops. And you know damn well the cops are going to go after you. I remember the case of somebody who went to rob the bank. He barely needed to wed his girlfriend. So, but he had no money. And but he didn't come out with the girl. And he just went to the bank. And then he told them he told the guy at the counter, the teller, he needs some money. The teller asked how much. So he mentioned the specific amount he needed to cover the wedding and extra wedding expenses. But the girl was completely unaware of what was transpiring. So, illicit acquisition, it brings anxiety. The Trusted case is also a case of illicit acquisition. So this guy, he was able to, you know, get the money from the teller, but then, you know, the banks, they are all wired with, you know, cameras and everything else. So he left, and then the guy, the teller, called the cops. So they put the footage of his activity at the bank on Facebook. Police also, I mean, they go away with social media, the cops. So they put it on Facebook, and his girlfriend, the girl he's going to rob the bank to be able to wed, he saw it on social media, and he called him up. I saw your footage. The police are looking for you. Go turn yourself into the cops. That was the end of the marriage. He's in jail right now. So, illicit acquisition can bring a lot of trouble. It brings a lot of anxiety. And in this case, there were a lot of, you know, bargaining, but, you know, it never got to any acceptable resolution with the Kuravas. And therefore, the end point or the final analysis was to go into battle. If you try everything else, if you try all the negotiations, then they fail. Peaceful negotiations, they fail. The last thing is war. So war basically is an inevitable end, because people will just not subscribe to every proposition regarding negotiations when there is a misunderstanding. So trouble. You go to the law courts, there are so many suits. I mean, here it's so easy for anyone to sue anybody else. I mean, what's the name of that lady that the one who is part-time in the army, presidential aspirant? Tulsi. The Tulsi Gabbard just sued Clinton for how many millions of dollars? The conflict when there's a
500 million.
500 million, yeah. If she's able to get all of that, you know, then wow, it'll be good for her. But you know, the point is, when there is a conflict, if then peaceful negotiations fail, either you head to the courts, or if it is a country against another country, then war. And so here, it's interesting. One family, the two cousins were fighting. Pandu's sons and Dhritarashtra's sons. They were brothers. But Dhritarashtra didn't want to part away with a land that could even fit a needle for his brother's sons. Greed is one of the basic causes of conflicts, wars. Sometimes even in the families, people are greedy, and they're envious of each other instead of being appreciative of each other. The money is going to the same purse. But why are you receiving most of it than me? Yeah, I've seen cases like that. And then it's also, you know, big conflicts, and then, you know, separation, divorce, and litigations, and all the rest of them. So greed is an important factor in the causation of conflicts, in generating wars. So here's a typical case. A Dhritarashtra mindset is very dangerous for anyone to imbibe. There is so bad. We think about Dhritarashtra 5,000 years ago, but there are so many neo Dhritarashtras on the planet. People who are just expert at accumulating, usurping. They are happy to see the members of their constituency suffering. And even what the possessions of their constituency members, they take them away by force because they have the resource, they have the money, they have the power. This is the case of Dhritarashtra. So this man looks strange. Why they're brothers and why Dhritarashtra just was adamant to the reality of sharing the assets of their father. I traveled recently, and I was in one of these middle states towards the south. I don't want to mention the place. But then, you know, my host, he told me a bizarre story. Bizarre. They are two brothers, himself and his older brother. Their father was very rich. He has so much of assets. But his older brother never wanted to see him at all. He lives in the US. The older brother lives in India. Older brother never wanted to see him at all. Now the father is late, so he took all of the assets. He told me the whole story. I told him, please, you just remain here. Don't try to go and make any trouble. Don't attempt anything. Just be here. Be satisfied with what you are personally developing and procuring. So we see the Dhritarashtra mentality, the Dhritarashtra mindset is very pervasive on the planet. I know of a case in one country, two brothers. One of them was very rich. He had a company, an organization, a transportation company, really big, was super rich. You know what his own brother did? He hired he hired assassins to go and kill him. Your brother, yeah. But then, in case during the investigations, you know, the police caught some of these people, and then during the investigation, they realized that they discovered that the brother was among, you know, the deal makers. In fact, the brother is the one who sponsored those so-called robbers to go and kill his brother. So this seems, this Dhritarashtra mentality is very dangerous. Unfortunately, this is very, very pervasive on the planet. At an era where we are talking about inclusivity and diversity. But no, these are just, you know, facades people use in trying to lure people into their programs and then, you know, annihilate them or, you know, usurp everything that, you know, that develops from that very project. So it's just so common. But an important point is that Duryodhana, during the fight, prior to the battlefield, Duryodhana has gone to meet Krishna and solicited for Krishna to give him his army. Yudhishthira, he went, but then he didn't want armies, he just wanted Krishna to be to be by his side. So here someone is believing in strength and power. The other person is believing in spiritual power. The other one person is believing in material power, material calculations. The other person is just devoted to Krishna, and he wants Krishna to be available for him. He doesn't want anything else. And basically, if someone has that type of mindset, he or she will be victorious, no matter the challenges that one may pass through. Because Krishna, wherever there is Krishna and Arjuna, there is bound to be victory. So sometimes people miss out the point that this is a typical example. You know, our high profile resources is not going to be what will prevent us from getting into a catastrophe. How our high profile intelligence, our high profile position, It's not the determining factor of our success in our encounters with other people. What determines to a great degree is our attitude. And so we find cases in Kali Yuga where people don't think about the principle or the concept of, you know, working together or coming together, and the results should be shared proportionately. But rather, people use, I mean, in so many countries, people establish companies or they establish firms, and then they use the youth, they just use their, you know, their energy to enrich themselves. And then they pay them peanuts. In some countries I've been to, I just advise young people who graduated from school, hey, just get out from this place. Go to another place to look for a job. Small countries, and they just milk these young people like anything. They use them for several hours a day for work. And it's all pervasive. Even here, especially those who come into this country, they don't have you know, papers. They enter illegally or they overstay and they don't have papers. You know, the people, they just use them to, you know, enrich the business moguls. They use them to enrich themselves, and they pay them a peanut. So the Dhritarashtra mindset is still very dominant on the planet. And one of the important factors here is that, you know, these days we are very proud of our technology. We are proud of our binoculars to be able to see what is happening at a distance. But, you know, these are just gross manifestations of the subtle potentials that have existed for thousands and thousands of years. We go gross and we think we are very advanced. We are more advanced than any other age. There are people, even in India, there are people who have the power. They go into the river or they go into the ocean, and then they appear the other way. They are in Washington. Oh yeah. So we are proud of our submarines. Some people, they will pass through this world. Some mystics, the yogis, will pass through this world without a crack. We are so proud of our ballistic weapons. But they were also ballistic weapons. In fact, they were very subtle. So in the military, in the Vedic age, in the military, you can send a ballistic weapon, but it's a very subtle weapon. And you can just target only one person. The person that was targeted, that very person is the one that will be attacked, and then the weapon will come back to the person who generated it. So these days we have developed the missiles, but they're just gross. It will go and attack that person. It will not destroy anything else. It will just come back. One person or two people or whatever. So who is more advanced, the Vedic age or the Kali Yuga? So there's a big difference between spiritual power and material power. And therefore, it is important also to understand that Sanjaya, although he was away in Dhritarashtra's home, far away from the battlefield, but he could envision all that was going on there and relate exactly what was transpiring to Dhritarashtra in the room. Again, that is, you know, a spiritual potency, spiritual power, mystic power. So there are people like that, but, you know, you could even have all of these mystic powers, but that, the Bhagavatam, in the Bhagavatam, in the 11th canto, where Krishna explains all of these mystic powers, is that in the comment, Prabhupada mentions that,
Yeah, these basic powers are theirs, but they could be a big distraction for a devotee. Because the tendency is that you begin to think, I can do anything and everything. And also, there's a tendency to abuse it. And therefore, it is important for us to understand that what we are seeing these days, they are gross manifestation of subtle potencies that have existed time immemorial. And the essence of cooperation is what could counter all of these animosities in our constituencies, in our communities. The essence of loving and caring disposition is what could really mitigate all of the negative energies that are big cloud in our environments, our settings. As soon as we live by the principle of aham mameti, this is mine. This is the killer mindset. The killer mindset, aham mameti. But we don't own anything. We are at best, we are, caretakers. The Lord is the supreme proprietor of everything. So the caretaker should properly take care of the facilities that are under his care or her care. But we should understand that being a caretaker does not in any way make us proprietors. Even Lord Brahma, the second creator of this universe, is a caretaker. Every mortal should be understood to be a caretaker. The proprietor is the Vishnu Tattva. The proprietor is Lord Krishna. So, when we understand this principle, then we could try to align with the principle of using all of these facilities in serving the Lord. And when we do that, we become purified. There will be no question of false possessiveness, which leads to wars, which leads to conflicts. Even in the families, as soon as somebody is claiming everything to be theirs, and instead of seeing the resources as for the family, for everyone to use, there is bound to be some conflicts. So this deterrent mindset, in fact, is all pervasive, is everywhere on the planet. And so, it's a good lesson for us to be able to understand that this war that was about to take place is really going to take place on a holy ground. And that was the basis of Dhritarashtra's fear. He was afraid that the Pandavas, and look, Prabhupada mentioned that he cleverly claimed his sons to be the Kuravas. And his brother's sons, they are not the Kuravas. He had already separated the family. He had divided the family for his own personal goal. And so this is also what goes on. Even when people say in a family business, you find this in the family business so often. Family business is growing. People begin to make some type of plans on how to take over or to kill the other sibling. It's so common. So we can't just point accusing fingers at Dhritarashtra. We are also small Dhritarashtras.
The Kali Yoga is just full of small, small disasters. The mindset is just, you know, it's there. Anywhere you go, you can find. In the families, in the organizations, in the communities, in the state, in the country, yeah, that false possessiveness is always there. So people need some clear understanding. The example of clear understanding, Prabhupada mentions here, is in the Bhagavad-gita. When people read the Bhagavad-gita, they will be able to have a fundamental understanding of who they are. Atata Brahma Jigyasa. Now, we are human beings. What is our inquiry supposed to be tailored to? Our inquiry should be tailored towards understanding our pristine identity, our relationship with the Supreme, and how to revive that relationship, which basically is like, you know, in a dormant state. The jiva has a chance to be able to reconnect with the Lord. The jiva also has an ample opportunity to always be drawn into the illusory energy. I mean, it's like you go to the bank of a river or bank of a sea during the ebb tide and during the flow tide. During the ebb tide, you see that, you know, the water has gone down. There's some dry land there. If you stand there, when the flow tide, you know, begins, eventually it will reach you. So the jiva is like that. It's tatasta. Tatasta means, you know, it's flexible. You can go here or you can go there. And so that's why, that's where we find ourselves. We can align with the illusory energy, or we can align with the spiritual energy. We can align with the Krishna's potency, or Antaranga Shakti, or we can align with Krishna's illusory energy, Bahiranga Shakti. The choice is ours. And when we align with the Bahiranga Shakti, there are a lot of implications to that. We get lots and lots of confusions. We make wrong decisions because of the principle of the mindset of aham mameti. Everything belongs to me, but nothing really belongs to us. As soon as we become cleared of that mindset becomes purified, then we are heading towards perfection. But without a clear understanding of our position in the material world, how all that surrounds us is just but, you know, to help to facilitate our growth in spiritual culture, in spiritual life. And so instead of utilizing the resources for ourselves, we could have as well utilized the same resources, because it's their Krishna's resources. And instead of getting into conflicts with people, we could really encourage people, we can align people with Krishna conscious tenets. And we'll find that with Prabhupada. He came here in this very storefront, and Prabhupada was giving class, and sometimes you find people bombs, they lie down right across, and you can't even pass. You have to meander like this before you go out. The Prabhupada engaged them. He did not discriminate against them. He engaged them. He served them. Can you imagine? It's very easy for us to serve someone. Some gentleman comes, and then we serve them very nicely, because we know this is a gentleman. He must be a big guy, or must be a big woman, or whatever. But a bum, the tendency is, get out of my way. Papa never did that. He served even the bombs. He served the hippies. He transformed them. So, and the end result, or the outcome was all glories. There was perfection that these very so-called bombs and hippies inherited from Papa's association. So when people encounter us, we should think,
we should be proactive. We should think how best to be able to help them. Not how best we can engage them. So example of Prabhupada, he taught how best to be able to help these people. He served even the drunks. Then they realized later and become so dedicated. And that's why you see all these young American boys and girls, they became so crazy after Prabhupada. They sacrificed the whole of their lives, their careers, their resources, their energies, their intelligence. And they helped Prabhupada to develop and disseminate the teachings of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That's how we, of the second generation, we are coming to take part in this Krishna consciousness. It wasn't easy. And so, when we look at it from a higher understanding, of a higher perspective, we could just realize that even these so-called disciples, they're not really like they're not ordinary people. They are part of Prabhupada's entourage. Because if Krishna is the greatest of organizers, he organizes, he sets up a situation, and then he also brings in different type of support systems to facilitate that spiritual positive change on the planet. And so, the opposite of Dhritarashtra is what is required for the general development of society. A general harmony in society is required. A mindset that we are able to have that equanimity to see to see that everyone is but our family. Just like Dhritarashtra, he sees all his sons as his family. He sees all his sons as the Kauravas. We should see everybody around as part of Krishna's family. And that will help a long way to minimize the conflicts, minimize the discrimination, minimize the uncomfortable situation that people have to face when they move out from their homes. And even in their homes, they are not comfortable. So that lack of awareness that we are all part of that great family, that big family, the Krishna family, or that aspect where we tend to see only the people who are favorable to us, or we create some in groups and out groups. I mean, like Dhritarashtra. Once we begin to create in groups and out groups, that's the typical case of Dhritarashtra mindset. These are my sons. The other of my nephews, no, they are not. Finish them up! But the reverse was the case. But the reverse was the case. Because he was dependent on power. Duryodhana was dependent on material power. Yudhishthira was depending on spiritual power. And spiritual power, basically, or material power, can't stand spiritual power. Therefore, Yudhishthira and his brothers won the battle. So each time we run into some challenges, we run into difficulties, we should think about how we can invoke the spiritual power. In other words, what does Krishna want us to do in this very circumstance? If we think about Krishna's enabling factor, then basically, you know, we'll be victorious like the Pandavas. The Pandavas, Yudhishthira, he was superlatively intelligent. He went to meet Krishna. You be by my side. He had a choice. He had a decision to make. But then he made a decision in a very pragmatic way, based on his spiritual realizations. Imagine when you have, you know, so much of military phalanxes, and then you're just choosing only one person instead of choosing the military. That's a super intelligence based on a very deep understanding of spiritual reality, deep understanding of the Krishna factor. So when we do have that understanding, and that understanding comes by reading the Bhagavad Gita according to Prabhupada. So we should take a step forward to form the habit of reading Bhagavad Gita. When we do it, it's possible you could do, but you could do reading every day. Why not? If you read, if even it's just a paragraph before going to sleep, you've done something. And if you go to read the Gita Mahatmya, you realize what you have done. The problem is, we don't seem to understand what impact the reading of the Gita plays on our lives. We think it's another mundane literature, and so we may have an excuse that we don't have the time. We have the time to watch television, but we don't have the time to read a paragraph from the Bhagavad Gita. So we should figure out where do we belong? A Dhritarashtra mindset or a Yudhishthira mindset? The chance is ours, or the choice is ours. We have to make the choice and then align ourselves with one of the parties, either Yudhishthira's party or Dhritarashtra's party. We don't like Dhritarashtra, members of Dhritarashtra's party. They are all over the place. So it is very difficult when your party is having a very small number, minuscule number. People want to go for the crowd, isn't it? Popular choice. Popular choice may not always be the right choice. And so, this whole event is happening on the place of pilgrimage. And the place of pilgrimage does have an impact on this whole decision, does have an impact on the world. Because that place of pilgrimage, which is very spiritual, helps those who are spiritually minded to be victorious. So if we are also spiritually minded, devotionally minded, no matter what circumstances we pass through, Krishna will arrange for us to be able to pass through the obstacles. Are there some comments, some questions? Yes.
Narottam Das Thakur has encourage that if we seek qualities within ourselves, we should, they're bad qualities, but we can engage them in Krishna's service. So my question is, if I recognize the Dhritarashtra mentality, I want to accumulate a lot, I can think, well, let me accumulate a lot for Krishna.
Okay.
Is there a danger there? Or
that's not danger there, but you have to bring it to Krishna. If you say you want to accumulate for Krishna, yeah, bring it to Krishna. Just don't use Krishna as a facade. Bring it, really bring it to Krishna. Yes. There's no problem. So I think someone was asking me a question. If you go to commit crime and then you give the proceeds to Krishna? I say, if only that is authentic and your spiritual master really instructed you to do that. Otherwise, it becomes sense gratification.
There was that example in California where the devotees, some devotees were trying to sell drugs and use the money for Krishna. Mm-hmm. But when Prabhupada found out, he was outraged.
Because, the point is that you can be ethical and be involved in unethical activities. This is a simple thing. Ethicality is counterproductive to unethicality.
Yeah, just to clarify, practically, to expound on the philosophical points you're sharing, it cannot be devotional service to commit a crime and give the fruits of the crime to Krishna, because the crime is not pleasing to Krishna. The beginning, before devotional service, the level of devotional consciousness is higher than that of a civilized human being, and a civilized human being doesn't do things that are criminal. Therefore, one cannot be a devotee and commit crimes.
Spoken by the lawyer, very nice.
See, that is this professor is late at Harvard University. He developed his theory. But, you know, I did some work on that post-conventionality approach. Basically, he's a materialist, okay? But the standard is that if you're a post-conventionalist, you know, committing anything crime is out of your way. Come on. They're materialists. But that is the standard. So there are people who are just post-conventionalists. They don't, whether it is to give it to a church or whatever, no, it's out of their way. They don't do it. So thank you for that input. Yes.
Is killing be considered a crime?
Killing. Except it is something else. But killing basically is violence.
So we see that Arjuna was killing.
Yeah. But Arjuna was basically... I'm finished.
No, I mean, I'm just kind of keeping
that. Yeah. People make this argument against devotees in some circumstances. They say, but if Krishna, if you are talking about, you know, non-violence, you don't eat meat means non-violence. So, but then Arjuna, your man, Krishna was, you know, pushing Arjuna to kill, to commit violence. So, can you help to shed light on that contradiction? Yeah, so the point is that Krishna, Arjuna has a duty to perform. I mean, it's like, you know, one devotee, he's a captain in the U.S. Army, so we are talking about, he was reminding me, because he said when he wanted to join the army, he has spoken with me, and I told him, so go and show them how to become a Brahmana. But he's a big guy now in the army. So he was saying that, you know, the place where he is, there's so much of, you know, nonsense activities going on. But if you're an officer and you're not partaking in those nonsense, people respect you. So look, even in the military, if you kill unnecessarily, I think one of these officers who was in Iraq or Afghanistan, he was being tried. It's only that the president, POTUS, intervened. Galaga. He would have been a problem. So even on the battlefield, there are rules. There are military rules you have to follow. There are military rules you have to follow. So yeah, Arjuna was being asked to embark on war or to go ahead and then fight, because that is he. Arjuna was a administrative warrior, means a military, a soldier. So how can a soldier say he will not go to war? That's what you signed for. That's your duty. So, and Krishna mentions in the Gita that it is better to perform our duties, even if we do it imperfectly, than try to do someone else's duties. So, the idea of Krishna asking Arjuna to embark on battle, I mean, on warfare, was because Arjuna, that is a military guy, and that is his duty. So he has to perform, whether it's going to bring a failure or it's going to bring success. The rest is up to... besides, Krishna, who is the creator of Dharma, he was personally instructing Arjuna, this is what I want you to do.
But Arjuna didn't follow the rules on the battlefield. When Karna was out of the chariot, trying to lift the chariot up, Arjuna killed him.
Mm-hmm.
But that wasn't... that's against the rules of Kshatriya.
Yeah. That was against the rules of Kshatriya, But look at, was Krishna there?
Yeah, I think he was in the chariot.
Okay.
Krishna actually told Arjuna.
Yeah. Right, but so then the argument is Krishna is supposed to be the upholder of Dharma. This is a Dharma.
Yeah, this is a Dharma, but you know, you can't make your rules against Krishna.
Krishna justified the killing of Karna to Arjuna.
Yeah, that was also justified. But then the point is that, I mean, okay, look, Krishna plays some type of pranks also. But then the whole thing is to favor his devotee to become successful. So we should try to be devotees. Krishna will violate even the law, the principles of religion that he himself enacted to favor his devotee. I mean, it's like you have a child. You have a child, and then he's playing in the village. In the evening, you went out and you saw your child, some of the grown, bigger kids, they surround your child, they want to mob him or mob her. You don't have time to go and ask what happened. The first duty is to save your child. Get up from here. And all those children will just disappear and you go away with your child. Later, you can determine why they wanted to harm him or her. So, if ordinary humans, we can go to that length, to that degree, or what about Krishna? So the important point is that when our dharma calls for a particular type of action, we have to do it. It might be challenging, but we have to do it. Arjuna was hesitant because, you know, his own relatives were also there. They were going to be annihilated too. And the point is, Krishna, the Krishna factor should be factored in. If Krishna wants us to do something, we should do it. If Krishna doesn't want us to do something, it might be very favorable. We might like to do it, but is it what Krishna wants? Or is it what your spiritual master wants? Because Krishna is physically not there right now before us, like he did for Arjuna. Arjuna was super lucky. Krishna was there personally. So you want to do something. Is it for your pleasure or for the pleasure of Krishna and Guru? And you can't say Krishna. So fine, consult your spiritual master. Fine, this is what I want to do. Is it okay? The unfortunate thing these days is that, you know, people take initiation and they already attain perfection. As soon as they take initiation, they already attain perfection. Because they don't align with even the spiritual master's instructions. And it's a problem. A big challenge in our society too. That creates a lot of challenges internally and externally. Because then you don't have a sense of direction. So yeah, Arjuna took, as you could tell, Krishna sometimes could just tell his close Buddhists to do something that could be so impractical. But they have faith in Krishna. A typical example is the case of Subal. That was not even a violent act, but Krishna gave Subal an instruction that is like impossible. They were in the groups playing, and Krishna told, all of a sudden Krishna called Subal and said, go and bring Radharani now. It is just so impractical because who will allow him to enter that compound even? And they know he's a friend of Krishna. But Subal went, and as he took Krishna's instructions to heart, he went and he was successful. That's a big story behind it. He went and he was successful. Even the unimaginable will be successful for the devotee when they follow strictly the instructions of Lord Krishna, instructions of the spiritual master. Yes.
Can I go again?
Sure.
I think this is very nice. Also, looking at it from a rule point of view, since it was pointed out that I'm a lawyer, so why not? So Krishna sets his rules for mankind to live by, and an even higher and the rule on which all of those rules are premised is that the purpose of following the rules is to develop devotional service to Krishna to please him.
Yeah.
And so therefore Krishna may on occasion show an example of how particular rules may not apply during certain circumstances, and therefore the highest rule of pleasing him might mean that you circumvent certain lower rules. And yet that's when Krishna or his purest or the pure devotees are setting that example. So devotees historically within ISKCON in their earlier days, there's been occasions where they thought, oh, okay, that means that, you know, we're above the law.
Now some people still think like that.
Yeah, sure. So the moral of that story of understanding those of Krishna's pastimes and understanding how they apply and understanding the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita, the philosophy, is that unless one is completely pure and is guided by the super soul, which means you can see super soul, follow his rules and don't think you're beyond them.
Sure. Thank you.
I was hearing Srila Prabhupada speak on the story of Ashwatthama when Krishna told Arjuna to kill Ashwatthama. So, and Prabhupada made a very important point. He said that even you may have some duty, you should understand what is the consequences of that duty. And based on those consequences, you may not have to follow that duty. And he was using the example when Krishna tells Arjuna, kill Ashwatthama. And then Arjuna thinks and comes up with a way of killing him and not killing him. And Prabhupada is praising Draupadi because she was saying not to kill him because of the consequence that will come back on his mother, who's already lost her husband and now she'll lose her son. So Prabhupada was emphasizing, even you have some duty, you must understand what is the consequence of that duty.
That's a good point. Sometimes we fail to understand that everyone, whether you're the Paramahamsa, no one is above the law. If the Paramahamsa hurts even an ordinary, so-called ordinary person, they pay for the price. So yeah, it's a dicey world. Yes.
I also think that it's just like, you know, the duty of the devotee to, you know, set exemplary acts for the rest of the world, you know, to live, even though some rules may seem silly, you know, in the material world, when you're a devotee, you know, just to lead the rest of the world by leading an ethical life is important.
Sure. That's a good point. And in fact, ethical people are very rare. So that alone, you know, puts you on a platform where people will tend to emulate you, like Krishna mentioned in the Gita. We set the standard, and you know, the whole world will pursue. So yeah, ethicality is so important. I mean, these days, you know, people, the people at the top, they're not ethical, and so a majority of the people at the top, they're not ethical, and so ethicality becomes like relegated to the background. If I can do anything, I can say anything, and you know, nobody checks me. That's important. So, yeah, being said, we have to see how we are, at least being ethical is important. Being ethical is important. I mean, I remember one day I was in DC, so one devotee was driving, and then I was sitting with him in the front. We were going to some place. And then, you know, the light, you know, the red light showed. And then there are two lines, two white lines in the front there. And he drove and passed, you know, even the other one, almost. So I said, hey, but you're supposed to follow the rules so that other people will see you as an example.
he just busted out laughing. He said, "Oh, yes, you're too strict. You're too rigid." Yeah, then, you know, we should, at least people will not come close to investigate our backgrounds. But externally, yes, we should also be ethical. We should set a good example for people. What's the time?
Okay.
So I think we are good to go. Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jai. His Holiness Bhakti Vasudev Swami ki. Jai Gaur Premanandi.